afternoon, and welcome to the Your Town radio and television program on historic AM 1240 KNRY and AMPS Access Monterey Peninsula, Cable Channel 24. Every weekday at 5 o'clock, we're proud to have as our guests various local civic and community leaders. The purpose of the program is to help inform listeners and viewers like you about some of the things going on in your town. And now, on with the program.
Welcome to Your Town Radio and Television Program. I'm John Sanders, Special Collections Manager for the Naval Postgraduate School Dudley Knox Library, and host for this evening's edition. A century ago, President Teddy Roosevelt sent a fleet of battleships on a world cruise that spanned 14 months and 46,000 miles. The epic voyage of the Great White Fleet brought many changes in U.S. international policy and naval affairs. With us to discuss this historic national event is Chuck Calvano, Naval Postgraduate School Professor of Systems Engineering. Professor Calvano's career has included numerous naval engineering assignments, including commanding officer of the Navy's David Taylor Research Center, and a recent assignment as chief scientist for the Office of Naval Research in London. Chuck, it's great to have you on Your Town radio and television program.
Pleasure to be here, John.
What was President Roosevelt's strategy for the Great White Fleet?
Well, like many events of this time, this type, I think there were a number of things that he had in mind, and for that matter, there were a number of events that led to it. The president had been very supportive of a larger Navy, and he was working very hard to get a congressional approval for a buildup in the Navy. At this particular time, though, the country was in a recession, and he saw that his buildup wasn't doing very, his ideas for a buildup weren't going to do well in Congress. So the idea of putting the Navy in a more visible position and supporting his desire to increase the size of the Navy was part of what I think motivated him and part of what he wanted to achieve. In addition, he was very interested, I think as we all know who've done any reading about Teddy Roosevelt, he was very interested in making sure that the world understood that America had arrived on the world stage and that we were now a large and powerful country. He wanted to make that point. And I would say a third driver for his desire to do this was there had been some recent tensions with Japan. And those tensions had been easing, but there was still an uncertainty, and there was already beginning to be a concern that Japan in the future might be a threat of some sort. So the president was looking for an opportunity to put some Navy strength in the Pacific. And that grew from a move of some ships to the Pacific, ultimately to the worldwide cruise.
Well, there was a lot of fanfare around this particular cruise, and we have an image of one item called Uncle Sam's Warships. I'd like for the viewers to be able to see if Sam could bring that up. And you can gain a perspective of how important President Roosevelt was, because he's really central in this image, and it's really quite patriotic in its display.
Well, patriotism was very much on people's minds. It was something that was very much on display. And the West Coast stops, especially those here in Monterey and San Francisco, were accompanied by a great deal of public interest. At that time, California was still pretty far away from the seat of power of the country. And I think a lot of Californians were very pleased to have the country paying attention to them. But there was quite a bit of hoopla and posters and postcards and things like that over the fleet's visit.
Interesting. Well, what was the condition of the Navy's fleet at that particular time? It was 1907 when the fleet left Hampton Roads, Virginia. Was the Navy in 1907 truly prepared for a 46,000-mile voyage?
Not really. In fact, a good many of the Navy's leadership were very concerned about this. In fact, they tried to talk Roosevelt out of it. They were afraid of the potential embarrassment of the ships getting halfway around and not being able to continue. The ships were undermanned. Most of the ships were only manned at about 50% to 60%. This also was a time of significant technological change, in fact, very rapid technological change. And some of the ships that went on the cruise, which were only 7 or 8 years old, were already viewed at the time as being obsolescent because change was occurring so rapidly. So the Navy was aware of the fact that the ships really weren't, many of them really weren't first rate on a world stage. They had never made a cruise of this type, and the Navy had never operated, the modern Navy had never operated in big fleets before this time, and they had to learn how to do that before they went on the cruise. So there were a lot in the Navy that were very reluctant, but Roosevelt being Roosevelt overcame any objections, and in fact, won the day.
We have a picture of one of the battleships in this fleet, the USS Vermont, and perhaps you could describe just a little bit about what the viewer is seeing when they look at this ship, because it's a very different profile and provides a very different view than today's modern naval warship.
Well, one of the things that some of your listeners may not realize is battleship and warship are not the same thing. A battleship is a specific kind of warship. And battleships were the successors of what, during the days of sail, were called ships of the line. They were the heavy ships with the big guns and the armor. And they were designed to slug it out with battleships of other navies. So the Great White Fleet was composed of 16 battleships. They were accompanied by some other warships, smaller ships, but these were battleships. And the Vermont, which is being shown, was a battleship. The Navy had only recently converted to steel construction for ships. Prior to that, non-wooden ships had been iron, and steel was still a relatively new material. Designers were still learning how to use it, and understanding things such as hydrodynamics, how to make the hull efficient in flowing through the water, was just being understood. So the hull looks a good bit different from what we're used to seeing today. But the ship has a number of guns, which I think are quite visible. Some of them are mounted along the side of the ship, which is a carryover from the days of sail when all of the guns were on the side. And then some of the guns are mounted in trainable turrets on the center line so they can be pointed in any direction. So, and the ship has no radars, of course, and very simple upper works, very simple superstructure.
And the upper works, in fact, were the smokestacks for the
smokestacks and a few masts for holding flags.
Well, there were a number of obstacles that you pointed out that Navy leaders, in fact, caused concern among them about this notion of a world cruise. What did they do to truly prepare the fleet for this voyage, prepare the sailors, and to organize and develop logistical plans?
Well, probably the most significant thing they did was change the way the Navy got its manpower. I mentioned that the ships were all undermanned, and none of them had a full crew. And the Navy realized they had to recruit to do this. Up to this time, sailors and Navy ships had come from sailors and merchant ships. And sailors tended to be older. They weren't young boys. And they tended to have been sailors for some years before they joined the Navy. So they tended to be a rough and tumble lot. But the Navy, recognizing it needed greater numbers, actually began a recruiting campaign. And for the first time, the Navy recruited in places other than seaports. So the recruiting campaign was nationwide and, in fact, was very heavily done in the Midwest. So there were a lot of Iowa farm boys who were recruited to go in the Navy. And, in fact, the term join the Navy and see the world comes from this recruiting campaign. And, in fact, they literally meant it. If you joined the Navy at that time, you were going to see the world in a round-the-world cruise. So that was one of the main things they did. Some of the other things they did was recognize that the ships of the day burned coal and had to refuel frequently with coal. So they began to plan for how they would place coal in strategic places around the world where the ships could stop and refuel. And in fact, had to resort, much to the Navy's embarrassment, had to resort to chartering colliers, which are coal-carrying ships, from the British, and did their best to keep that out of the newspapers.
We weren't on good terms with the British at that time.
No, things had been a bit tense. Britain was not a close friend at the time. Britain had, during the Civil War, which was not that far in the past at this point, had very much been thinking of coming into the war on the side of the South. They had allowed the South to build warships in their ports. The CSS Alabama was built in Britain, and the USS Kearsarge had to go to fight the Alabama and ultimately sank it. So the close kinship with the British that we think of today really was pretty much an outcome of World War II.
You had mentioned the attitude of Californians about the fleet and its future arrival on the in various ports in the West. In general, what was the American public's reaction to Roosevelt's plan?
Well, it was very positive. In fact, in this Naval History magazine that you have here on the table, there's an article by a modern PR expert, public relations expert, about how effectively Roosevelt conducted public relations as part of the Great White Fleet. One of the things he did, and to answer your question shortly, the reaction was very positive. The public was very interested. In fact, during the cruise, the progress of the ships was on the front pages of many, many newspapers throughout the country. It perhaps wasn't the headline, but probably under the fold on the front page, you could have daily read a synopsis of where the fleet was and what port they were going to visit next and how things were going. So that was there was this very strong tide of patriotism. The country had just experiencing large waves of immigration, people who thought they were coming to the promised land, and there was a very pro-American patriotism. In 1907, there had been an exposition in Jamestown, in Norfolk, Virginia, to celebrate the 300th anniversary of the settling of Jamestown. And Roosevelt sent the fleet to be there for the Jamestown Exposition. And they were anchored just off the waterfront in Norfolk, where all of the visitors to the Jamestown Exposition, one of the things they saw quite obviously was the battleships of the Atlantic Fleet. And they were a very popular sight.
Well, that had to have been a dramatic sight for all of those visitors, because these ships, not only were they painted white, but they had some gilded, several had gilded bows. The regalia, the lighting, right, was probably quite dramatic in both in day and at night.
Yes, the Navy at that time was painting the hulls of its ships white, and then the superstructures were kind of a mustard yellow, perhaps a Dijon mustard yellow that they called buff. And in fact, that was one of the bones of contention with the Navy and Roosevelt. The Navy had always expected that in a wartime situation, the ships would be rapidly painted gray because they would be less visible. You didn't want your ships to be visible at great distance at sea. And because there were still tensions with Japan and the ships were going to visit Japan, the Navy wanted to paint them gray. But Roosevelt wouldn't let them, said he wanted them to be white because it looked better, made a bigger impression. So the Navy, unbeknownst to Roosevelt, although he probably wouldn't have objected, make sure that each ship left with plenty of gray paint in its storage rooms so that they could paint themselves gray if tensions were to arise sometime during the cruise.
If there were any kind of incident.
Right.
Well, so the fleet left Hampton Roads, Virginia, the Norfolk area of Virginia, in December 1907. It steamed to South America, rounded Cape Horn, began to return to U.S. territorial waters, and made its first West Coast American port call in San Diego. Then it moved on to Monterey and arrived here in early May of 1908, and from there on to San Francisco. What was the response in California as the fleet came?
Well, we alluded to that a bit earlier. It was really quite huge. In fact, there were some interesting rivalries that occurred. Santa Cruz there was a bit of rivalry between Santa Cruz and Monterey. Santa Cruz liked to say that the Great White Fleet had visited Santa Cruz, and Monterey insisted that the fleet had visited Monterey. And of course, Santa Cruz and Monterey share a bay. I believe you have a photograph that shows the ships just off the Del Monte Pier, clearly in Monterey. But there was a bit of a tug of war, if you will, between Santa Cruz and Monterey for the honor of being able to claim that they were the host city. And of course, the ship did stop in San Francisco. There are some wonderful pictures of the fleet in San Francisco Bay at night with the ships illuminated by searchlights. But there was a tremendous outpouring. It's possible to find lots of examples of posters and postcards and things that were made at the time, advertisements. Many, many companies took advantage of the fleet's visit for commercial purposes. Mm-hmm. And we see posters and brochures and leaflets and handouts which would talk about the fleet and then just mention in passing that XYZ company is the place to go for your storm windows or something like that.
We have one postcard that shows California welcomes the fleet, and if Sam could bring that up in the control room, I'll just mention that one person who came to Monterey to see the fleet was a gentleman who became known as Pop Ernest, and he developed his famous abalone recipe as a result of that particular trip, and then set up his restaurant along Fisherman's Wharf. And then we also do have that photo that you mentioned of the Great White Fleet in Monterey Bay, and you can clearly see the ships at anchor, and in the foreground you can see the pier for the Hotel Del Monte, which is today's Naval Postgraduate School. Several people, dignitaries, came to Monterey because the hotel had a huge ball, grand ball. The Secretary of the Navy, the Governor of California, many, many local dignitaries, state senators and congressmen were all here in Monterey for that big celebration with the Great White Fleet here. The Hampton, the port calls and the countries that the fleet visited between its departure in 1907 and subsequent return in February 1909. From your particular research on the fleet, what were some of the more notable places internationally that the Great White Fleet made calls, and what was the impact?
Well, it was interesting in that the fleet actually made more stops than were originally planned. And one of the reasons that happened was cities that were not on the agenda complained and demanded that the fleet stop there too. So as the fleet was going down the Atlantic coast of South America, for instance, if it stopped at the Rio de Janeiro, then Buenos Aires wanted to know why it wasn't stopping there as well. So cities were added during the cruise. Two places that were really especially, and by the way, everywhere there were balls, there were parades, there were fetes of various kinds. So it was a bit of an extended party, kind of a dream cruise for a sailor. Two places in particular that really rolled out the red carpet were Australia and, of all places, Tokyo. The Navy was reluctant to go to Japan. In fact, Japan wasn't originally on the agenda and was added again at the insistence of the Japanese government. And the Navy was still a little bit leery, and one of the reasons the ships were carrying gray paint, the people that, or the country that the Navy thought might be the troublemaker that would cause them to have to fight, was Japan. Mm-hmm. And the Navy was reluctant to hazard the ships in Tokyo Harbor, but in fact, because Japan made such strong overtures, they did go to Tokyo. And in fact, the largest crowds of the whole cruise were in Tokyo.
That's really fascinating.
Yeah. And in fact, it was generally conceded, in fact, it's referred to in the article I referred to, this latest issue of Naval History Magazine, about Roosevelt's PR successes, that in fact that visit significantly changed relationships between America and Japan for the better.
Well, we're going to take a short break with Professor Chuck Calvano. We're going to continue our discussion because there were many practical lessons that were learned during this voyage, some technical, others geopolitical and social. Before we go to break, I'd just like to note this is the issue of Naval History Magazine that you've referred to a couple of times that has two excellent articles on the cruise of the Great White Fleet. So we're at Your Town Radio and Television Program, and we're going to be back in just a moment with Professor Chuck Calvano to continue discussing not only the Great White Fleet, but engineering and naval affairs today. Welcome back to Your Town Radio and Television Program. I'm John Sanders, your host tonight. Our guest is Naval Postgraduate School Professor of Systems Engineering, Professor Chuck Calvano. And we've been discussing the epic voyage of the Great White Fleet between 1907 and 1909. Chuck, just as we went to break, you were beginning to talk about some of the global significance of this cruise. So let's recap some of the highlights from the first segment and continue the discussion about those important lessons learned. First of all, the geopolitical lessons learned by the Navy and the nation by sending this fleet of battleships on a 46,000-mile global cruise.
Well, I think some of the things that were brought home, I think they were understood beforehand, but they were brought home more strongly, was that you can't do this sort of thing and be a world-girdling Navy and just leave port and steam. You have to have made preparations. You have to have places where ships can stop and refuel. And of course, as we mentioned earlier, these ships were coal-fired, and when they refueled, it was a big operation, took about 2 days. And you had to have a source of coal, and you had to do that in port. With more modern ships, of course, we can refuel at sea with oil. But that capability didn't exist then. And this was a big challenge for the Navy to find places where they could pre-locate stocks of coal. And as I mentioned in the first segment, they actually had to resort to hiring British coal colliers, coal-carrying ships, to bring the coal where it was needed, which was a great embarrassment. Because a big reason for the cruise was to let the British know that their several century-old dominance of the sea might not continue forever. But we had to resort, unfortunately, to using some of their ships. There were a number of other lessons learned. I think the Navy learned that perhaps younger officers were an important thing they had to look into. The Navy hadn't been in any significant action or combat since the Civil War, which was now, at this point, 40 years in the past. And the officer corps consisted of quite a lot of elderly gentlemen. And some of them were senior officers in the cruise, and quite a few of them became ill. And a lot of officers had to be replaced in the cruise. And that wasn't easy to do because there were no airplanes to fly officers out to meet the ships in other ports. So I think that might be one of the things they learned. They also learned that the kinds of engines that the ship had, which had been common when they were built but was beginning to be changed, they were what are called reciprocating engines, which were steam engines, but they had very large pistons, like the pistons in a car, that went up and down and turned the propeller shafts. But these pistons weighed several tons. And so when you have a several-ton piston moving up and down at high speed, the vibrations are horrendous. And the ships found that in long periods at sea, they almost literally began to shake themselves apart. The Russians had the same experience in 1905 when the Russian fleet had sailed from European Russia all the way around to fight the Japanese fleet. And they arrived in a deplorable state because they had made a long cruise with those kinds of engines. So some of the engineering changes that were on the horizon, the Navy rapidly recognized the need to adopt, such as turbine engines, which didn't reciprocate and which didn't have cause these big problems.
I want to come back to the technical in just a moment. Let's touch on the social. Sam, you have a photograph of the Great White Fleet in Monterey Bay. As you mentioned in the first segment, this was an incredible cruise because there were parties and especially events everywhere the sailors went. And Monterey Bay was one of those special places. The Hotel Del Monte had a particularly notable party, and the sailors all came. And Fighting Bob Evans, who was in charge of the fleet at the time, unfortunately became ill after the port call in Monterey, and in fact had to be replaced, as you had mentioned. So the lesson on the younger officers was quite true. Now, Sam, also, if you'll bring up the picture of the USS Vermont, one of the ships, battleships in the fleet, so that, Chuck, if you would, let's now really drill into some of the technical lessons learned, because for several years prior to this cruise, an admiral in charge of the steam engineering, marine engineering program for the Navy had been an advocate for the development of an advanced education program. Right. And it seems that many of the technical lessons that were brought home during this cruise bore out all of his, vindicated him, because the Navy did not establish an advanced program until the fleet returned home.
That's true. George Melville, Admiral George Melville is the man you're referring to. And for 16 years, he was the admiral in charge of the Navy Bureau of Steam Engineering. And he was really quite a remarkable man. When he'd been a younger officer aboard ships, he had actually been aboard ships during the Civil War. He had actually undertaken some espionage missions, which had he been caught by the South, he would have made himself vulnerable to being hung as a spy. And was strongly commended by his commanding officers for being a great engineer officer of his ship. After the Civil War, when we were doing a lot of Arctic exploring, he was the chief engineer of one of the ships, the Jeannette, which was caught in the Arctic ice for 2 years until finally the captain decided they needed to abandon the ship and try to walk out of the Arctic. And they broke into three parties. The commanding officer took one-third of the crew, the executive officer took one-third, and Melville, the engineer, took the other third. And the only party that made it out was Melville's party, and he didn't lose a man. The other parties died to a man. He was given a special congressional medal by Congress as a result of this feat. So he was really quite a man, quite a leader, quite an officer. And then as he became more senior and took on more bigger engineering responsibilities as the head of the Bureau of Steam Engineering, he personally designed the engines, a new kind of engine for a cruiser, which for many years held the speed record for naval ships. And he was responsible for many technological changes. He took the Navy from what are called tube-fired boilers in steamships to water-fired boilers. Without trying to get into the technical details of that, let's merely say that the water-fired boiler was much more efficient and required less maintenance. He initiated a number of such improvements, but he recognized that engineering knowledge within the Navy was not sufficient, and the Navy needed a growing cadre of officers who understood engineering, as the Navy was becoming more and more engineering intense, and we were going away from sail-driven wooden ships to steel ships which were driven by machinery. And in 1901, he wrote a letter to the Secretary of the Navy advocating the establishment of a school ashore to give graduate education in engineering to naval officers. That and several other points were the origins of the Naval Postgraduate School. The postgraduate school was not actually founded until 1909, 8 years after Melville wrote his letter, but the discussion went on for a number of years and congressional back and forth, as well as other people weighing in, and ultimately the decision was made to establish the school that he had recommended in 1901.
He actually retired from the Navy in 1903, I believe. Yes. And so he'd been in retirement prior to the departure of the
right.
Great White Fleet. Do you happen to know if he saw the fleet at any point on their
cruise? No, I don't know that. That would be an interesting thing to try to find out.
Well, certainly his ideas, he was an incredible pioneer, and he had the credibility, yet the Navy just didn't quite see the return on investment for creating the advanced education
well,
program.
Well, it took the Navy a while to accept the idea of engines and ships in any case. I mean, there are a lot of anecdotes of officers in the 1880s and 1890s who didn't particularly want to use the engines because they got the sails dirty and things like that. And the coal-burning engines of the day were not pleasant to be around. They put out great plumes of black smoke. And most of the officers, because they were aging and because we didn't have the modern career management system where officers pass to and retire at a relatively young age. That wasn't the case then. So they had grown up in sail, and sail was good enough for them. And there were many of them that were reluctant to make the changes. But there were, of course, many pioneers as well. One of my favorites was David Taylor, who I think along with Melville is the co-patron saint of modern naval engineering. And it's interesting to see how much the world has changed. In 1898, David Taylor, who was a naval architect, designed ships, testified to Congress about the need for the Navy to have an experimental model base and a tow tank where ships' models could be towed to experiment with hull shapes. He did this as a commander, which was a middle-grade naval officer with no entourage, just a commander all by himself, went and testified to Congress. Congress agreed, appropriated the money to build a model basin, which was built in the Washington Navy Yard, and then Taylor ran the model basin, and they began to do some experimentation. The results of the early experiments were actually incorporated in six of the ships of the Great White Fleet, the USS Connecticut class, incorporated results that were learned at the model basin. And the Connecticut was built in 1906. So from 1898, when Daler proposed the idea, they built a testing site, they tested ships, learned from that, and incorporated the lessons in a ship, and the ship went to sea all in a span of 8 years.
That's quite remarkable. And this particular time period when Taylor was proposing the development of the Research and Experimentation Center happened to be a time period in which there was a tremendous amount of scientific and engineering vitality. And that provided a much broader context, I think, to the lessons learned by the Great White Fleet and the Navy.
Yes, it did. And in fact, at this time, in about the time the Great White Fleet was departing, Great Britain launched a ship that they had built in great secrecy called the Dreadnought, which was a battleship. And it was a different style of battleship. The guns were placed differently, and the ship was referred to as an all-big gun ship. Prior to that time, battleships had guns of three or four or five different calibers. The Dreadnought only had two calibers, very big guns and sort of medium guns. But it was a very different arrangement of the ship, and it was immediately perceived by most people that it was a much more effective way to design a ship. The Dreadnought also had steam turbine engines and some other innovations, which were then rapidly imitated by all the other navies, including ours. Although with a class of battleships that we built about 2 years later, the Dreadnought idea was actually improved upon, and the class of battleships we built in about 1912 were improvements on the Dreadnought. But yes, there was huge amount of change. There were developments in armor. In fact, prior to the Great White Fleet, we had bought all of our armor from Europe because we didn't have armor-making technology in the United States. And this was about the time when we were learning how to make good armor. We were just learning how to make the big guns in the ships. Prior to that time, the big guns had been bought in Europe as well. And we had established a gun foundry at the Washington Navy Yard in Washington, and they were now manufacturing the large main guns for battleships and other Navy ships. So there was a good bit of scientific development. And I think I mentioned earlier in the first segment that some of the ships that went on the Great White Fleet cruise, which were only 6 or 7 years old, were viewed by the Navy as obsolete. And they were only 6 or 7 years old.
And on the world stage, you also had early pioneers in flight, like the Wright brothers. The automobile industry was beginning to emerge and change the way people around the world viewed transportation on land. And the radio was beginning to become prevalent.
I don't think any of the ships of the Great White Fleet had radios or wireless, as it was called. I think that was just a bit later before that went to sea. One of the big impacts, frankly, that the Navy had on the country was steel making. The Navy became a major user of steel. And that the Navy orders, which were demanding armor and high quality steel, actually played a big role in the development of the U.S. steel industry.
Well, technologies certainly have not been static, and they've advanced quite markedly since that time. Let's fast forward about 40 years to the post-World War II era. What were some of the striking technical changes in Navy ship design and engineering in the post-World War II era versus the period of the Great White Fleet?
Well, between the period of the Great White Fleet and then World War II itself, which was, of course, the source of much innovation. Wars always bring about a lot of technical innovation. And then the period right after the war, I would say some of the big changes are, one thing, ships were quite a bit faster. The ships of the Great White Fleet were 15 or 16 knot ships. Battleships of World War II era were, the last class, the Iowa class, were 32 knot ships. And they were quite a bit larger. But other major developments had occurred. For instance, the concept of fire control. Fire control in a Navy context means the control of the fire of your guns. We're not talking about fire control as a fire department, but control of the fire of your guns. In the era of the Great White Fleet, guns were still aimed by the gunner. The gunner actually looked down the barrel of the gun and aimed the gun. Shortly after this time, we began to see in ships the installation of fire control systems where an officer high up in the ship could determine what the aim point was and could control the aim of all the guns. So fire control, right after World War II, we were beginning to see the introduction of missiles, guided missiles, replacing guns in many respects. And of course, the aircraft carrier during World War II, which introduced the ship that made battleships obsolete.
Yeah, I hate to say it, but we are running out of time. I'd like to do another fast forward, because after your stellar career as a naval engineer, you came, joined the Naval Postgraduate School faculty specifically to develop a program that was called Total Ship Systems Engineering in the 1990s. Why was that an important program to establish then? How has that program met a Navy and naval need during the time that it's been in existence?
Well, the Navy had for a long time spent small numbers of officers to graduate education in ship design at MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, which is actually where I got my graduate education. But we had begun to recognize that, and that program was built on a foundation of what we would call naval architecture, ship design, hull forms, and propulsion, and so forth. But we were beginning to realize that in modern ships, more and more of the important developments were in electronics, electrical systems, combat systems, weapons, and sensors. It was seen as a good idea to take officers with a good grounding in mechanical engineering or electrical engineering or combat systems engineering, the development of weapons and sensors, and giving them an introduction to ship design, because modern ship design teams needed to have experts in all of these fields. So the Total Ship Systems Engineering program was intended to complement the program at MIT, which would produce ship designers who had a strong foundation in naval architecture, and we at the postgraduate school would produce ship designers with a strong foundation in mechanical engineering or electrical engineering or combat systems engineering. And all of those officers together would give the Navy a strong cadre of technical expertise underlying the process of ship design.
Just before we went on the air tonight, you were telling me about one of the student team projects from the early 1990s that has now come back in vogue because of a particular need.
Part of the program is that each group of students, which performs as a team, does a ship design at the end at the last 6 months of the program, and we make those ship design projects widely available. I've had a lot of people ask me, well, has the Navy ever built any of the ships your students designed? And of course the answer is no, and that will never happen. By the time we've done a design project, the students have probably got 10 man years of effort into the design, whereas the design of a real ship at that point would have hundreds and hundreds of man hours in it, or man years. Many of the ideas that we came up with in our designs have resonated and come back. The Coast Guard has recently embarked on a very large project to more or less rebuild the entire Coast Guard. It's called Deep Water. And there have been some difficulties with that project. It hasn't gone as smoothly as people would like. And there have been a number of individuals now, including some congressmen, are asking the question, why don't the Navy and the Coast Guard build a ship that both services could use? It could be in slightly different variants with slightly different payloads, but perhaps basically the same ship, and that would reduce the cost, which is getting to be a big problem with modern ships. Well, we did that in 1994, and in fact, we've made available copies of the student design that we did in 1994 to those who are interested in further exploring the idea of a joint Navy Coast Guard ship design. I don't know what'll come of that, but it's interesting to note that that we were doing it more than 10 years ago.
And I think it's important to note that the officers who came through the program at that time are professionals in their service.
Yes.
And able to integrate fairly readily some of these ideas and capabilities as the service requirements emerge.
Well, that's the intent of the program. And in fact, many of the early students now are relatively senior officers. Some of them have actually finished naval careers and are now working in industry. And in fact, just next week, we'll be visited by one of the graduates from our very first program who has since retired from the Navy and is now working for a large defense contractor. And he wants to come and just spend some more time talking to us about our ideas and so forth. So a lot of the ideas that the students and faculty have had in this program, I think, have percolated in small ways into the Navy, haven't necessarily revolutionized it, but have contributed to modern designs and modern programs.
Chuck, it's been great having you as a guest on Your Town Radio and Television program.
It's been
a pleasure.
I'll
have to invite you back because I'd like to talk about the future of systems engineering, but we're just out of time. We're going to take a short break. Stay with us. Sue Higgins, the Deputy Director of the Sobrowski Institute, will be the next guest, and we'll talk about the Navy's new maritime strategy. Thank you. Our next guest is Sue Higgins, Deputy Director of the Naval Postgraduate School Sobrowski Institute. Sue, we're going to discuss the Sobrowski Institute's work a bit later in this interview, but I'd like to start with a little added perspective on the prior discussion with Systems Engineering Professor Chuck Calvano, because the origins of the Naval Postgraduate School lie in this revolutionary scientific and engineering period that swept the globe in the early 20th century. The crews of the Great White Fleet served as a final catalyst that convinced the Secretary of the Navy that an advanced education program was a necessity. Today, world affairs in the 21st century have convinced Navy leaders that it must have more than scientific and technological prowess, and that awareness was really expressed profoundly in the recently released issue of the New Maritime Strategy. I'd like for you to pick up on this maritime strategy that the Navy released in October. And what are some of the key tenets in this new strategy?
John, the maritime strategy that was released in October was the first in 25 years. So think about how much the world has changed in the last quarter century. We were smack dab in the middle of the Cold War during the last one. It was time to release something new. Something that's different about this one is that the last one was focused on sea control, controlling the seas. This one, in its title, states that it is a cooperative strategy for the 21st century. So it's really a strategy that is focused throughout it. There are statement after statement talking about how the maritime services. This is signed by the Commandant of the Marine Corps, the Commandant of the Coast Guard, and the Chief of Naval Operation, talking about how the maritime services can achieve not only protection of the United States, protection of United States interests, protection of economic interests of the United States, but increasingly it really acknowledges that those economic interests are so tied to the rest of the world that cooperation with the rest of the world in achieving those goals is really paramount to our own security.
You've used a couple of very important phrases. One of them is that it's a cooperative strategy. Never before in the history of this nation or this nation's Navy has there been something that's been referred to as a cooperative strategy.
That's correct.
Could you just go, let's explain that just a little bit more for the audience.
There's so much that's changing now, obviously, in the world, and so much of the work that the military does is reflected in some, not just the maritime strategy talking in this language of cooperation, but other top-level documents are using the same kind of language. There's a directive that was released by the Department of Defense in 2005. The audience can do a Google search on DOD Directive 3000.05, so Department of Defense Directive 3000.05. And it talks about the work that is prevalent in Iraq and Afghanistan, this work we call work that's around stability operations, reconstruction, transition operations. And in that directive in 2005, it's a short document, but it outlines the fact that non-combatant operations are as important as combatant operations for military work. Then in 2006, early 2007, the president announced, President of the United States announced the stand-up of a new command. A new large regional command called AFRICOM, Africa Command, taking pieces from other regions and focusing now a single region, single area around Africa. So is the military planning on, you know, major combatant operations in Africa? Actually, just the opposite. This command was stood up with State Department as a deputy in this command. That linkage of State Department and Department of Defense is a first as well. This linkage at the beginning of focusing on cooperating with other agencies inside of the U.S., and the agency that's focused on diplomacy rather than war fighting. The fact that's in the premise of this command says a lot. And then following that is the maritime strategy. Now, that the maritime strategy has some key lines in it. Although its focus is on, like I said, is on maintaining a sense of peace and prosperity for the citizens of the United States. That's, you know, key focus of the Navy that we have. But the part that I find just really exciting is this line that continues now from these other documents, and it talks about prevention of war fighting as important. Prevention of war fighting is as important as winning wars. Prevention of war fighting as important as war fighting. This starts creating a whole different set of dynamics about how military work is changing. I mean, it really starts outlining this trend. What I'll call a trend. It's not that militaries are going to radically change the work that they do, but the fact that there's a different kind of an opening now for an acknowledging that in this world, globalized economies, and this world where we are right now in the 21st century, acknowledging that cooperation is really a key part of maintaining our own security. That's very different.
It's a huge philosophical shift, because rather than having a strategy that says these are important goals, critical goals to provide a war-fighting capability, you now have a statement that's official, an official position, as you said, that says we need to prevent wars. That means that there are a number of detailed issues that probably naval officers and other military officers need to learn, that and skill sets they need to acquire that go well beyond the current training regimen that they receive.
The kind of skill sets it's very interesting to think about the kinds of skill sets that you need when you're confronted with crisis. And you have an automatic reaction that says that anybody who confronts you is an enemy. Your training, your background in training, in a traditional sense, says that everybody that is around you is going to be an enemy, and therefore you're going to react in a certain way. The U.S. military was involved in a variety of ways in the relief operations in the tsunami. Indonesian tsunami 2004, 2005, and in Hurricane Katrina operations. There was a Navy ship off the coast of New Orleans. There were Naval Postgraduate School faculty and students who were taking relief operations kind of work to Bay St. Louis, Missouri, to help in these relief efforts. So these are young officers who are being confronted with relief work in a way that that they certainly were not trained to do. And one of the things that struck me, it was an interesting thing that I found when I was reading some of the daily situation reports from the commander in charge of the Katrina relief efforts. And this is a standard report that's put out to any military operation. And there was a line in there that I will always remember, and it said, "Remember, these people are our fellow American citizens. Remember that they are not our enemies, they are our fellow American citizens." And you have to drill that in every day. He said that to his young officers. There is a shift in mindset here. But the young military folks that we're encountering in these kinds of situations are rising to these challenges just beautifully.
About a year ago, a Naval Postgraduate School alumnus, Mike Lefevre, came back to campus. He's now an admiral, and he had been in charge of the humanitarian recovery operation in Pakistan after that devastating earthquake. And he noted that one of the guidelines that had initially been set was that the medics would carry a handgun. would wear a handgun, mm-hmm. and that it took a little bit of time to have that set aside, but he ensured that no medic went out into the field to work with the Pakistani people and carried a weapon of any kind. Mm. And interestingly, the Navy conducted an assessment prior to engaging in large-scale humanitarian aid, and then afterwards, and they could see a definite shift in opinion about the United States, mm-hmm. Far more favorable opinion that the Pakistanis had for the United States and the United States military, because rather than being confronted with a force, even though that force might have been providing assistance, they were confronted in a much more constructive way, in a way that better fit into their culture. Mm-hmm. And I think these are some of the things that you're touching on.
When Admiral Lefevre was here, I had the opportunity to have a conversation with him in one of our lunchtime venues. And I remember a couple of things so clearly from his description of his time there. The first was, he said, speaks to the world is changing. he said, here I was, a Navy admiral, and there was nothing in my training that prepared me as I was working up to make admiral for being in charge of the largest airlift in history since the Berlin airlift in a landlocked region. you know, with no sea in sight. That was one thing that talks to these changes that our military is having to become involved in. The second one, he said, was he talked about something that I thought was just very, very poignant. He said what he came to learn in his time there was the importance of slowing down and drinking tea with the Pakistanis. Mm. And the new maritime strategy speaks to that kind of issue as well. One of the lines in the maritime strategy is that while we can surge where we need to, trust and cooperation cannot be surged. This notion that in order to build these cooperative ventures with people around the world, that it's going to take some time to do that. It's going to take time. And the Admiral's comment about drinking tea with the Pakistanis is one that has resonated with me so much. I've thought, as we're building new programs for our young military to grow into taking leadership roles, some of the things that we're working with them on is learning how to build civil military relations, and learning how to be as comfortable with with civilians, as our young people are with military. Now that's not usually too hard, mm-hmm. for our younger people to do, but sometimes we have to slow them down a bit, you know, so that they can create those connections that they need to, or that they can find those areas that they have in common, and then they can go forward together toward common goals. One of the things that's changed since the time of the Great White Fleet, and then since the time of the Department of Defense was actually formed in 1947, post World War II, is that in that time, say in 1947, there were, I believe, three non-governmental organizations. And I can't tell you, I've heard this number, there were approximately three or four, just a handful of non-governmental organizations, what we come to call NGOs. There's a website that I go to periodically that has, where NGOs are creating a presence for, a collective presence for themselves. It's called wiserearth.org, all one word. The last I looked, there were 108,000 organizations that were listed on that site. Now, when our military is involved with these kinds of relief efforts, humanitarian assistance, disaster relief efforts, part of the landscape in those geographic areas where they are these NGOs, are people who are there with the best of intentions as is the U.S. military, but their efforts are interweaving. And learning how to blend with those efforts of the NGOs is one of the areas where the U.S. military is having to learn. There's a lot of learning going on right now.
A tremendous amount of learning. I think it's remarkable that the Naval Postgraduate School has officers from more than 50 countries. Mm-hmm. Admiral Michael Mullen is the current Chief of Naval Operations. He happens to be a Naval Postgraduate School alumnus. And one of the things he said is that knowledge and imagination are the keys to the future in national security. Mm-hmm. And he said at the Naval Postgraduate School, those keys are forged. Sue, I hate to say this, but we have run out of time. There are so many important things that are in the maritime strategy. I hope that you'll come back. We'll pick up this discussion in a future program. And I want to thank you very much for being a guest.
Thank you so much, John.
And thank you for joining us on this edition of Your Town Radio and Television Program.
Thank you for being with us this afternoon on the Your Town Radio and Television Program on historic AM 1240 KNRY and AMPS Access Monterey Peninsula Cable Channel 24. If you have any thoughts or ideas about the Your Town Radio and Television Program, please give us a call at 831-899-2600. That's 899-2600. Or send us an email to yourtown@montereyradio.com. The Your Town Radio and Television Program was created and developed by MontereyRadio.com.